Hey guys, welcome to Laugh Napkin. On today's episode of Pro Revenge, we have a super satisfying story of workplace revenge. OP absolutely wrecks her supervisor, ending in him losing his job and getting arrested. If you're new to my channel, go ahead and subscribe for dailies. Now let's get into it. My shift supervisor at work was a petty tyrant who treated me like garbage, so I got him fired and arrested. I work as a computer technician now, but when I was in college, I worked part-time at a well-known chain cafe. Let's call it Seattle's Finest. Other than babysitting or odd one-off under-the-table work helping at friends' booths at Renaissance fairs, it was my first job. The manager, Eliza, had aspirations for rising in the company at a corporate level, so she was obsessed about making our store the finest, Seattle's Finest. At the time, though, she wasn't an especially effective manager at the store level. She didn't really know how to make all the drinks, and had to constantly refer to the recipe cards, even though she was supposed to be an expert on everything. She also didn't really care to learn, which meant that during a particularly busy rush, she would never step in and help us in making drink orders. She would just hole up in her little office in the back, near the kitchen. However, she had a college degree, and our company's policy, at least at the time, was that only college degree holders could be the full manager of a store. She left the day-to-day running of the store to Steven, the lead shift supervisor who had been working at that location for 25 years since he was 16.
"And the only reason I'm not a manager is because I don't have a college degree."
He never tired of reminding all the workers that the store would go to crap if he wasn't around. Steven didn't really have much to do, other than delegate others to do things and make sure orders were sent out to suppliers and to sign those orders in when they arrived. Our store followed standard company practice, and so a fixed amount of supplies was usually ordered in every day, and only slight variations to account for particular store needs. For example, we might order 60 chocolate muffins a day, while company average is 100, because our store was next to a yoga studio, and the ladies who came in ordered less of the fattening items. Steve also wrote the schedule every week. When I was hired on, Eliza was the one who interviewed me, and she assured me that I'd get at least 20 hours a week, 4-hour shifts to coincide with my school schedule, and I only worked Saturdays on the weekend, not Sundays. During my 2-week training period, she kept her word. I'd hover right around 18 to 22 hours a week, 4 to 4.5 hours at a time. After that, however, since I was fully trained, she passed me over to Steven. Steven followed Eliza's pattern for about a week or so, but soon he began trying to schedule me in the mornings, which I couldn't do because of school. He'd pretend to get really angry and disappointed, and talk about how,
"In my 25 years with this company, one of the first things you learn is to be a team player."
Well, I thought that was great, but I still couldn't work in the mornings. So he'd grumble and say,
"I'll have to talk to Eliza to see what we have to do about you."
Eliza would only occasionally show up to the store. Usually she was there mid-morning and left well before closing. Steve would always open the store.
"I've been opening the store for more than 20 years, blah, 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 blah."
Steven would try to suck up to customers and at the same time condescend to us in front of them.
"Forgive her, she's new. You see what I have to work with? Raw recruits."
Sometimes he'd outright call us dummies if we couldn't clean things up fast enough or make drinks quickly enough. Like, he'd be hanging out in back, counting boxes. Meanwhile, it's 12 p.m. on a Saturday and I'm running the register and making all the drinks and our line is 10 deep and he sent his other worker off to lunch and he himself refuses to help.
"You've got to have your baptism of fire."
He took himself way too seriously. He thought he was special because he spoke fluent Spanish. Since he worked in the morning, a lot of the people who had early morning jobs would come in, and many of them spoke Spanish only. He thought it was his specialty that he could communicate with them. Well, my father is from Spain, and I happen to speak fluent Spanish myself. So one Saturday when I opened the store with him, I started speaking Spanish to one of the customers, and the customer complimented me on how well I spoke the language. Steve looked like he was ready to murder me. Whenever customers would come in who spoke Spanish, rather than let me communicate with them, Steve would get up off his butt and say, "I'll handle this." As time went on, Steve would only schedule me for 8 hours a week, like closing Friday night and opening Saturday morning. I thought, whatever, I'll just start applying to other jobs. I didn't tell him that, though. I knew he was giving all the hours to his favorites, usually young women who he tried to flirt with. I know because he tried the same thing with me at first. He said that he could give me more hours, but I had to play ball. Nothing that I could actually prove in court, but he was hinting that if I go out with him, he would give me more hours. "No thanks, man. You're gross. And married." Well, Eliza was up for promotion to district manager, which meant that she would oversee 5 or 6 Seattle's finest coffee shops instead of just one. However, in a whole team meeting one special Sunday, she said that our store consistently was losing product. She warned us to stop giving discounts to friends, stop giving away free cookies or snacks to friends, etc. She also said that if we planned to have some of the pastries ourselves, we were allowed a certain amount of free product depending on the hours we worked. We had to make sure to write it down on the store use board. At least during the hours I worked, I never witnessed anyone giving away free product, and certainly wasn't using any of it myself. No one gave stuff away, other than Steve. Steve got a bonus every time the store use board was below a certain threshold, and he would always accuse us of stealing or giving away things. In fact, he said so at the meeting, that "shrinkage is caused by these rookies who think a company runs on fee-fees. It's a business based on cold money and we're bleeding it when we steal product or give it away." Meanwhile, I always noticed Steve giving free discounts to certain customers and giving things away. One of those rules for thee, not for me, type things. Another worker actually asked him about it, and he said, "Managers have certain privileges." Dude, you're not a manager. You make $3 an hour more than me, and you've spent your whole life here. He also resented the fact that most of us who worked in the store were college students who would eventually move on someday to something hopefully more financially profitable. Steve would do this working class hero bit where he would talk about how college people were snobs, didn't know how to do real work, were lazy, and privileged. He also mocked me for majoring in computering as a female, and accused me of just trying to get my Mrs. degree. He acted like he was kidding, but he was still really slimy. Then he went back to his homily about how business people's whole day would collapse without people like him to get them started the right way, with coffee. "I'm as indispensable to a large corporation as the CEO. Meanwhile, we're all thinking, "Calm down, Steve. You're a shift supervisor at a suburban coffee shop, and you wear an apron with your name embroidered on it. You're not curing cancer." But anyway, Eliza's promotion depended on the store reducing its shrinkage. On a date a few days from our Sunday meeting, company bigwigs would come to the store and check out how well Eliza ran things. We were told to look sharp. The bigwigs would be in the dining room, chatting with Eliza while the rest of us who were scheduled that day tried to look our best. Steve didn't really have any incentive to make Eliza look good, because as long as he kept overall shrinkage beneath a certain number, he would still get his bonus. Also, it wasn't as if Steve would become manager if Eliza got promoted. The company would still get a new manager as an outside hire. Informally, we'd call Steve assistant manager, but the company didn't officially recognize him in this capacity. Since he was a longtime worker and worked full-time, he did get health benefits and a 2-week vacation. The rest of us lowly part-timers just got a store discount and some free food or drink while working. We got paid every 2 weeks, but we got tips every single week. If you've never worked in a coffee shop like Seattle's Finest, customers would throw money into a jar at the register if they felt like being generous. The tips would be emptied out every night, and eventually at the end of the week, all the money would be parceled out to all the workers, depending on the hours they worked. Since I only worked a few hours, my tips were small, but at least it paid for laundry. My school starts a couple of hours after the store opens, and since I wasn't burning too much energy working, I'd get up nice and early every day. The store was close to my apartment, and I always walked there. It was the time of the year where the moon was still out early in the morning. I decided that I'd walk to the store and get my tips for that week. I approached the store from the alley entrance, but I intended to enter through the front. Store policy was that you could only enter the back way if you were scheduled to work. As usual, at that hour, our daily supply truck was pulling out of the alley, and there was a huge stack of daily supplies in the crates outside the back door. Steve propped open the back door with a trash can, and was carrying one crate at a time into the store's back room. My first instinct was to help him, but then I remembered that I wasn't being paid, and besides, that Steve was a total a-hole. I was fascinated watching him as he worked, because usually he was such a lazy jerk. I was hidden by cars and trees so he couldn't see me. He stopped working, but there was still a crate left at the back door. It was filled with what looked to be croissants and random boxes of granola bars. In addition to coffee and pastries, our store also sold third-party nutrition bars, the kind where you can buy a box of six for $4 at the grocery store, but we'd charge you $2.99 for one. He was talking on his cell phone, and only a minute or two later, a beat-up car pulls into the alley. The driver pops the trunk, and Steve puts the crate into the car, and the car speeds off. Steve then goes back into the store. At first, I tried to rationalize what I had seen. Maybe it was just a work-related thing that I didn't understand because I wasn't a shift supervisor. Maybe the person in the car was from another store, and our store was supposed to send our items to them. I decided to forget my tips for the time being, and walked back home. By the time I got there, I realized it was most likely that Steve was just a thief. I went to school and forgot about it for a few hours. But every now and then that day, I'd think about it again. The next morning, I woke up and I made sure I had my cell phone ready. I waited outside really early, even before the supply truck came. And when it did come, sure enough, Steve did the same song and dance as the day before. He left one crate outside, coordinated with his accomplice on his phone, the same car arrived, and it pulled away after Steve packed his trunk with stolen goodies. I thought I was being real slick in recording the scene, but later when I reviewed what I had, it was way too dark and unclear what was going on. And if I tried to get closer to get a better picture, or where there was more light, Steve would see me and my cover would be blown. I actually worked that day because it was a Saturday. Steve was his usual douchewall itself, but hearing him banter with customers, it reminded me of other pieces of other conversations I heard from him over the past many weeks. Steve had a side business, or at least his wife did, selling snacks outside of clubs and sporting events. I put two and two together and realized that if Steve stole even one crate and sold off its items at a massive discount, he'd make a pretty penny and all of it profit. And he had stolen a crate 2 days in a row. Who knew how many more crates he had stolen in the past? I realized that if I told Eliza, she wouldn't believe me, and Steve would deny it. I had to catch him red-handed. The approach I'd been making to the alley was too far to record him without being observed, but I saw that there was an apartment complex on the other side of the alley. If I could somehow get into that apartment complex, all I'd have to do is quietly hold my phone over the brick wall, and it would be close enough to record him. That was precisely what I did. Staking out Steve's stealing became my morning ritual for a week. Out of 4 days, he stole a crate 3 times, and each time I had him recorded. I wasn't scheduled to come in until an afternoon the next week. Now, all I needed to do was show Eliza my phone, and I'd nail this bastard. Unfortunately, she wouldn't be in the store for a while either. But then I remembered that the big company meeting regarding Eliza's promotion was coming up that Monday afternoon, just a couple days later. I wasn't scheduled to work, but I knew I could talk my way into the back room with an excuse that I needed my check. Our back room has a computer where we clock in and clock out. It's just one window on the screen. If you click out of it, you have access to the rest of the computer's functions. One thing the computer always has running in the background is what we called Store TV. It was basically just a series of short infomercials about how wonderful Seattle's finest coffee was, how our beans are from plantations where workers are treated humanely, how we donate to underprivileged communities, offer funding to women in STEM, and things like that. The file was stored as a WMV file, and the store just played it on a continuous loop. Every so often, Eliza would obtain a new set of infomercials and we'd loop those out. Our store had one big screen mounted from the ceiling which faced out into the store, away from the registers. My plan, obviously, was to upload my video of Steve stealing onto the store computer. I had the files, which I combined at home into one big file of three occasions, where you could clearly see his face and the face of the woman driving the car, who I'll assume is his wife, and how they clearly are stealing product from the store. Eliza and the big bosses were already there at the restaurant, so the sensible thing to do would be for me to say, "Excuse me, Eliza," and just brazenly interrupt her meeting with my cell phone video held up to her face. But I love a bit of drama, and Steve had this coming. So I see Eliza with her colleagues sitting at the table near the registers, where Steve is standing with a crap-eating kiss-butt grin on his face. The store isn't really crowded. Eliza sees me when I come in, and in full I love my staff mode says, "Oh, everyone, here's OP, one of our newest and best. She's going to college for computing." Followed by a bunch of nods and pretending to give a crap. I smiled and mouthed the words, "I'm just here to get my tips." "Of course, OP." And Steve looks like he wants to slap me with his little wee-wee. But too bad, I'm going into the back room, jerkwad. Our tips are placed in little baggies labeled with the amount in our cubbies in the back room, with an honor system not to go grabbing anyone else's tips. I grab my tips, $11.50, not bad, then I go straight for the computer. I have my phone's data cable and plug it into the USB port of the store computer. I upload the file, as planned. I unclick the propaganda channel for Seattle's Finest and switch it to Steve the Thief, and set the video for continuous loop. I come out into the restaurant, and as usual, no one really cares about the TV. I go to Steve and order a hot latte. Steve looks like he wants to stab me in the throat, but he still has the crap-eating grin on his face because the bosses are all there. He doesn't know that just a few feet above his head, there's a continuous loop of him and his wife stealing product in the alley every morning. I had made sure to include a time and date stamp on the videos when editing. He already had some hot milk ready, and all he had to do was pull two espresso shots. I had my drink in 30 seconds. I pulled out my wallet, but uncharacteristically, he smiled at me and waved me off. Eliza saw me and nodded in approval. Then I sat at a table not far from where the bosses were sitting. Above Steve's head, his video was playing silently. Finally, the payoff. One of the bosses said, "Say, Eliza, that isn't our company video of donations to minority scholarships. What is that?" Eliza looks at the video. Everyone else looks at the video. Mouths agape. Only Steve is still standing there like a grinny ninny. Finally, Eliza says, "Steve, can you explain what's going on here?" Steve looks at the video and looked for a second like he was gonna run out of the room like Usain Bolt. He didn't do or say anything other than run into the back room. Seconds later, the video stopped, and a few moments later, it began playing again. "Haha, Steve, I deleted the correct video and made a duplicate of your video and renamed it as if it were the propaganda channel." Everyone in the dining room was once again treated to a loop of Steve and his wife stealing the entire crate of designer granola bars and pastries repeatedly. One of the big bosses says, "Eliza, let's close the store, right now. Young lady, I'm sorry, but..." He pointed me to the door. "Who am I to argue, sir?" I walked home with $11.50, but I felt like $1,000,000. A couple days later, I get a call from corporate, thanking me for the information about Steve. "No, sorry," they tell me, "they can't give me details about what happened, as it's a police matter." Anyway, as thanks, a week later I received $200 in store credits. A few days later, I came in to find neither Eliza nor Steve at the restaurant. One of my coworkers told me that she heard that Steve was arrested for theft, both he and his wife. Eliza got her promotion because it was proven that the only reason her store had moderately high shrinkage was because Steve was stealing. However, because she was supposed to be keeping a close eye on Steve, she was being watched carefully to ensure that she's actually a good employee. Well, that's fair. She wasn't a thief, but she should have kept a closer watch on her store. The whole getting a full-time salary but only showing up for a few hours a week thing wasn't acceptable. As for me, the new manager got me my final check because I quit. I went and applied for a job on campus at my school's off-brand coffee shop. Same basic job, a few jerks here and there, I'm no prize winner myself, just saying, but I did make a buck an hour more. As time went on and I graduated school, I did eventually learn that Steve was not only stealing product, but also embezzling tips and tampering with the time clock to reduce people's hours and give himself more. He went to jail for 6 years, but his wife got a suspended sentence because they had 2 children under age 13. I learned this because the company I work for now actually did tech service for Seattle's finest corporate office, where Eliza now works. She remembered me, and over the finest coffee in all of Seattle, she told me the whole story. Thank you so much for watching this video. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I enjoyed making it. Big shout out to everyone that has subscribed to this channel, as you're the ones making these daily videos possible. See you guys in the next video.